called Nelly Ben Hayoun-Stépanian. I go by the she-they pronoun. And I speak with an accent, very, very strong French accent, unfortunately for you today, because we're going to be together for like an hour, right? And I'm going to like ravel through all of this political theory, design, politics, you know, all of these things at the same time. It's going to go super fast. And the more excited and passionate I get, well, the more French I sound, unfortunately. So hopefully it will make sense. There will be bullet points. I never put bullet points, but I thought, you know what, we're going to have bullet points at the end. But anyway, we're going to speak about, you know, how we can support organized communities through platforms and through different, you know, design projects that have been kind of happening through the past, you know, decades and that I've been lucky to be involved with. But I think at the core of everything I'm going to talk about today is really this notion of radical imagination, right? And I'm going to tell you what it means, but I'm also going to try and like develop through the practice how I put into practice this notion of radical imagination. How do you, you know, how do you really support, I would say, social dreaming within the context of our society at this point in time, through design, but through also events and other medium. You know, I'm not just limited to design, and I think that's important to say that. And how do we also think long-term? How do you also support this organized community you're gonna put together and support and develop through a project, but you know, how do you support them for the long run? And well, since I've had the immense pleasure I'm gonna weave a bit, so bear with me. We're gonna go through a lot of different tangents because, as you probably have gathered, my big thing is non-linear learning and non-linear delivery. So none of this presentation is linear. So we're gonna take a little step back, and I'm actually gonna share something with you that I don't share really often, which is a shame, I think. But you know, I actually come from textile initially. My background is in textile design. And it doesn't come out of nowhere. My granddad actually was, you know, one of the Armenian leaders of the Armenian diaspora in France, who actually got the Armenian genocide recognized in France, was into textile. And my entire family, when they arrived in France, was into textile. So it's a big, you know, I think it's a big thing, especially for community that arrive in a new country to kind of like gather around a specific craft. For me, it was really textile in a way. And you know, that kind of like took me to learn about making kimonos in Japan, where I got invited when I was, you know, 19, basically to go and study. And so I was learning, you know, kind of ancestral technique of making kimonos and, you know, kind of learning this discipline, because this is what it is. And I think it's something that really is kind of like at the core of everything I do. And it taught me a lot about, you know, like perseverance, about actually patience as well. With things, even though you might think that I'm not really patient given the speed at which I deliver this presentation. But, you know, like also like techniques of, you know, different techniques, marble, you know, and so forth. And so these were kind of some of the design I would come up with when I was in Japan, in Tokyo, learning with this three master Takadano company. So it was three brothers teaching me, basically. And as you can see, it was kind of like quite a clash already at the start. Anyway, moving on from that, I just, you know, I kind of like think that actually textile has got like such an amazing opportunity. And actually, I will invite you, an amazing opportunity, sorry, to actually really get you to unravel, I will say, either past histories, but also kind of like rally a whole community behind the making of whether it's an object, whether it's a piece of art, whether it is like a piece of clothing, whether it is, and that to me is in a nutshell the kind of the practice I put in place whenever I go into any form of institutions, right? How can I go at it trying to actually build this craft that is not there at the beginning, perhaps, build a community around it and actually sculpt it to actually like shake it from inside. I think textile has got this amazing opportunity, and actually someone that talked about this amazingly well is Priya here, and the Offbeat Sari exhibition, which is currently at the Design Museum, and I'm not supported and paid for by the Design Museum, but I just want to say it's an amazing, amazing exhibition that not only is sublime and sublime you know, because of the aesthetics that are being proposed, but it's also in terms of like the reclamation of ownership that comes through the development of these patterns, you know, and that's at the core of, I think, a lot of migrant studies or a lot of, you know, I would say communities that actually arrive in spaces that are not, you know, they're kind of their homeland. But I think this is an interesting one for me because also I work a lot with brands, right? And it's interesting because in this specific project, I actually was using a marble technique, which is a technique that I learned when I was doing kimonos. which, you know, I don't know if you're familiar with marble, but it's like, you know, you have some sort of like, you know, water with some liquid in it. It's a bit of a secret, so I'm not going to go dive into it. But if you ask me after, I will tell you. And then you put this ink and it kind of like, you know, the ink is going against the water. And then whenever you put the textile, effectively, it gives you this kind of like very fluid pattern. And it was interesting to me because, you know, obviously Porsche is what we know, you know, like a car company. And this was like an electric car that they were releasing. But they are also a massive, gigantic platform. And through the mean of this project, I was actually able to speak about the Armenian genocide. And I was able to speak about, you know, the techniques that were used to actually make this pattern. And actually kind of like bring it back to, you know, some elements of my heritage, which was interesting because then a lot of Armenian people then recognize themselves through this thing. So for me, it's how can I, every single opportunity is a good opportunity to kind of like, you know, maybe weave in an alternative history that perhaps has not been told or has been suppressed or, you know, and kind of like use it as a mean to actually speak about other things. So partly, I mean, this project was about many different things, but the pattern was very much like informed by that heritage. And the other side of that was also the idea that, you know, what is permanent mobility? How does that look like? How does that feel like? And I will say to you that for the past years or so, and especially with this project Tour de Moon, I've been trying to figure what it is to develop an alien aesthetics. You know, what does that mean? How can you support movement and, you know, how can you support platform that they don't have a name for themselves? They don't exist in transdisciplinary, they don't exist in multidisciplinary, they don't exist anywhere. And you have to kind of like completely reinvent the entire lexicon that comes with it. And that's kind of like what I'm very excited about, which is, to your point, like I'm eager to learn, you know, like from other fields like economy and others, so you can kind of like merge all of these, you know, all of these weird elements together, because weird is actually a fantastic word in itself. Like, you know, you can define it in such sense. Anyway, I took a bit of a tangent there, but I'm gonna take you back to something, you know, which is a studio, actually. And I think a studio is something that is so at the core of any design practice. And, you know, we all take it for granted, but in my case, it was kind of like I needed to make myself, you know, look massive, because I always wanted to do really large projects. And in order to make people believe that I was like 55 different people, I started to call myself a studio. And believe it or not, but it did work. So, you know, like I will go around, I will be like, hi, you know, I'm Nelly. I'm the director of Nelly Ben Hayoun Studio. You know, like, hello. Like if this thing was like this huge entity, you know. But anyway, eventually it did grow. And we are now a multidisciplinary studio, which is, you know, very much manufacturing pluralistic future, working across multiverses. We basically really are there to actually like modify, you know, modify institutions from within and really support youth counterculture. And actually what that means effectively is like, for me quite effectively, we're distributing wealth. So every single project is always an occasion to think about mode of redistribution and decentralized model and how we can put this into practice effectively. This is, you know, I mean, this is kind of like how we work really, like that's a bit of the roadmap. You know, like, I mean, I'm giving you all of my secrets here. I actually don't know that we are being recorded, but I feel like I'm in trusted hands, right? But this is, you know, this is how we organize. So the studio is kind of the core of the financing system. I mean, this is the economy of the studio, effectively. It might not look like it, but it is how it works. The studio make, you know, projects in collaboration with brands and others. And, you know, we can kind of like be quite commercial in that sense, so we can actually generate funds. And then these funds are then being redistributed into all of the various ventures that we support, whether it's in education, whether it's in events, whether it is through policymaking at the Astronautical Federation, or whether it is through the development of independent films, for example. So all of this is kind of like a permanent, you know, I would say it's always in expansion, it's always growing, it's always expanded, it's never set in stone. But this is how it's been working for us for, you know, more than a decade. So it seems like this is a working economical model. Believe it or not, we're still going. And I'm going to share with you one of the videos that Marina, actually, from our team has been putting together. I'm sorry, it's very commercial driven, but I mean, in a nutshell, it would give you a sense of what we do, so I'm going to share it with you. What you're going to experience right now is going to be very much close to what I call the total bombardment.
Our team on the ground are currently investigating the subject matter. So in a nutshell, what we do is we design experiences, we make dark energy in people's sink, we give you the experience of a volcano inside your living room, we give you the full liftoff experience of a Soyuz rocket, all the while you are, you know, on a Friday night wanting to experience stage 1, 2, and 3 of the Soyuz rocket. We also give you a sonic boom experience, you know, when a particle is traveling faster than the speed of light, how does it feel like, how does it look like, you know? But we also make installations where we try to think about how we can tell stories that are nonlinear, that are kind of bringing all of these different elements you learn at school separately, like biology, physics, you know, literature, but like bring it all on the same roof. And that's kind of like what I'm really excited about. So this is, for example, an installation we developed at La Gaîté Lyrique, which is about the different sources of energy. And the bottom line is when you think about Marie Curie and the finding and the discovery of uranium, you don't specifically think about, you know, the sun, or you don't think about the bacteria inside your intestine, or you don't think about the fungi and the mushrooms. But actually, all of these things are generating energy in a different way, but in a very similar manner. And all of these things are connected. So surely, when we learn it at school, we should probably learn it on the same roof as opposed to like learning it in a very linear and compartmentalized way, right? So this is effectively a very gigantic playground, and you will find that throughout the entire practice. This idea of trying to bring together people as well through play and humor. A lot of the work is really humoristic because effectively you can jump onto a giant squid, arrive inside your intestine, go by Marie Curie kind of like sections, and then find yourself outside of it. Part of the work we do as well is we design extreme experience effectively for disaster management crews. So like FEMA, for example, or, you know, I don't know what would be the equivalent in the UK, but like, you know, like fireworks or firemen, sorry, and so forth. So in this case, for example, teaching them how to react in case of an asteroid impacting the planet. I mean, believe it or not, there is training going on for this kind of stuff. And so we will design this kind of stuff, and then we will train them, or we will take students to Chernobyl, for example, where they get to experience, you know, basically the place, or I would say what technology can make when it goes disastrous and when, you know, actually emergency methodology are not being thought through all the way, you know? So what happened in this case? And so we will take them there, or we will look for, we will put expedition together as well, where, you know, like, for example, I will be looking for form of life to send in outer space, like which form of life do you pick and things like that. Anyway, like you mentioned, are you still with me? Or is everyone, you're okay, you're alive. It's a lot to text through, yeah? But it's only gonna get worse from now on. So you mentioned it, Priya, but we are actually 3, and lately we actually have triplicated to being 6 because it's even more of us. But one thing that I've always been fascinated about is, like, you know, my entire business model, in a way, is that working, is relying on, you know, we do a lot of public speaking, right? I don't know if any of you is familiar with public speaking, but the way it works is, like, you know, there is a ranking system. Now, I have a PhD, I have more than a decade into this industry, but for some reason, my male colleague will always get paid more, will get the business class fights, you know, like all of this stuff. And I was like, what is this? You know, like, how does that work? And I thought that was so completely, you know, first, I think this whole system doesn't make any sense. So in a way, what I started to do is to think, how can I pervert this system so that, one, I can earn more, and two, I can actually effectively have a critical conversation about the way that people are being, you know, kind of product of themselves in that sense. And so this is how it came about. So I was like saying to people, well, fine, you don't want to pay the full deal, then you're gonna get one of my copy then. Which of course is kind of like mental when it's a reality, because people will laugh about it and be like, yeah, sure, Nelly is gonna send us a copy, but yeah, wait until you actually get the copy. You know, and then that's kind of like how it happened. So then we suddenly, like, I got a, you know, a per value kind of scheme, and that kind of like supported us to actually create the University of the Underground, create a lot of the project that we do, because effectively we were able to actually upgrade my, you know, I will come, deliver a talk, come back, cash in, and that will mean we will be able to like maintain the studio for another few months, you know. So that's kind of like, in a nutshell, the way we do things. So let's talk a bit about the SETI Institute, because I just would love to also share that with you. You're probably wondering where all of this is going.
But I think it's important in order to understand the way, you know, I will put a project together, to understand also that for me it's never about one voice, it's never about one audience, and it's always about trying to also bring in with me all of these different community, whether they come from science, they come from economics, they come from politics, they come from, you know, and actually allow for these debates to happen through these mediums. So the SETI Institute is a search for extraterrestrial intelligence institute. Now, I don't know if you know about the search for extraterrestrial intelligence institute. Have you ever heard about it? Is there anyone that has ever had SETI at home in there? Yeah, anyone? Yeah, good. Okay, two people. So this is not a space audience, clearly, which is great. But I will say to you, like, so back in the days where, you know, citizen science was invented pretty much, one of the biggest projects that happened at the time was like something called SETI at home. And SETI at home was the idea that, you know, we receive and we collect a lot of information from all of these observatoires and telescope coming from, you know, all over the world. But we didn't have the power to actually grind all of this data. So people were invited to give a space of their computer for the use of the SETI Institute so that they will actually support the search for extraterrestrial intelligence. Because when you're looking for something that we don't know what it sounds like, effectively extraterrestrial intelligence, how does that sound? Then you need to come up with new strategies, right? You need to start looking at, you know, different frequency that come from the universe. So you, I don't know if you know, but we have like telescope listenings, listening everywhere in the world for like, you know, what might be out there and some sort of like signal that might sound different, that might sound engineered by another civilization. And so it's a fantastic place to work at because effectively it's a complete pluridisciplinary place. It's a scientific institution. It was funded in 1986 by someone called Carl Sagan and Jill Tarter. And it was initially a NASA endeavor until it became independent and became a charity. And the idea of the Drake equation, which is the kind of, Frank Drake was one of the founding members of the SETI Institute. He unfortunately passed away a few years ago, I mean, not even like 2 years ago. And he came up with that equation, which is actually trying to like define how many potential civilizations might be out there. Now, I mean, think about it. How do you even start to map out this kind of like completely irrational quest? Like how many, and of course, it's irrational, but it's not at the same time. Given the size of the galaxy, like effectively, we are not gonna be the only, you know, civilization. So effectively, this comes down to, you know, the rate and the formation of the stars in the galaxy, how many potentially habitable planets there is. You know, so each of these different components are basically unknown. So how many, and then the more you kind of like define each of these unknown, the more you get to actually a closer number of how many potential civilization, extraterrestrial civilization that might be out there. So that means that effectively you need to hire people that come from completely different realm of expertise. So for example, at the SETI Institute, we will have someone listening to whales or dolphins, you know, and how they respond to each other, and how that might inform the way that we might look for extraterrestrial intelligence, for example. And that's kind of like an amazing place to be into and to actually mingle, because you really expand your just the way you think, it becomes completely elastic in a sense, because you realize very quickly that everything that we have on this planet is directly connected as well to the way that we might be looking for other things on other planets and other potentially civilization and so forth. And actually, the way we see things is extremely limited. So having said that, that kind of like took me slowly and surely into policy making, which I will say to all of you as well, like is a beast in itself. It's partly the reason why I went into like academia and I started to do the, like all of the, you know, academic stuff, because I realized that actually once you do these events, and I'm gonna show you some of the projects that we've done, well, you know, then you have to pitch it. And then you have to actually really change things for the long term. And when it comes to changing things for the long term, then it looks like this. And what I'm saying by this is like, what is it that I mean by it looks like this? It looks like, effectively, a bunch of old white heterosexual men, kind of like, you know, mingling on their computer, all knowing of each other, all from the same background and the same heritage, and not questioning themselves about whether or not we should open the door to all their viewpoints when it comes to the future of humanity in space. And that's kind of, you know, maybe you don't think this is an urgent quest, but I think it's extremely urgent that we don't just let other people make a decision on the future of, you know, humanity as such. Because that's what this is gonna look like, effectively. So, you know, you can go and be a creative and be doing all of this amazing work, but the reality is, like, if you're not gonna go in there, then that work is not gonna, you know, it's not gonna have any legacy in the sense. And so that's how we started to like develop all of this project and so forth. And that's how he kind of like driven. Now I'm gonna take another little route here and kind of like share with you some of the learning as well I've done, I got from working in this institution, specifically like scientific institutions and other institutions in general. So someone that is at the core of the way I practice design is someone called Hannah Arendt. Now, she's not a designer. She's actually a political theorist. She died in 1975, and she predicted that humanity will eventually go alienated and will end up disappearing from Earth. In a nutshell, she was depicting, you know, she was talking about Oppenheimer and the atomic bomb. I'm sure some of you have been going to see the Oppenheimer movie. Have you gone there? No? You've seen it? Yeah. Well, so she was talking in a book about the human condition, about the fact that if we don't urgently change the way that our institutions are organized, then we're going to maintain as such a kind of, a no reflection as to why is it that we are doing these things. So Oppenheimer was seen on record being very apologetic about the fact that he actually made the atomic bomb. And the reason why he probably didn't realize that he was making the atomic bomb is because he is an engineer, he's a scientist, and you know, he thinks that perhaps, he got sublimed by the technological tool, and he actually didn't think about the fact, the repercussion of his making. So what's fascinating to me is to see that actually we still function in this manner where, you know, you have science, you have directorate, so you have people who think and the people who make, which is in a nutshell the way that Hannah Arendt depicted, animal labyrinths, the people who make, homo faber, the people who think, and the two of them, they don't mingle with each other, they don't have conversation. So In a nutshell, this is kind of like where I started to be fascinated about, you know, organigram, the way that institutions function, whether it's a scientific institution and others, and try to identify where are the places of, you know, where is the power being defined, and if it's not decentralized, then how and where and why is it in such place, and how can I design an event that is going to challenge this, this kind of like very well-oiled kind of like a repetition of, you know, I will say history in some sense. I'm just gonna share with you quickly this this extract from a movie called I'm Not a Monster, where I effectively go all around the world to ask, you know, different thinkers and different, you know, activists and others, actually, if I was to bring back the origins of knowledge into my suitcase to my students, then what does that look like? What does that feel like? And what does it take to bring any thinking into action? What is knowledge? Who owns our thoughts? Can a monster think? Who controls what we think? Do you think you are dangerous? How do we structure knowledge? Do you think that there is like a rigid format for debate? Can you sing a song about knowledge? So knowledge is directly connected to economics. What makes you become a monster? Do you know what the weight of the Rosetta Stone is? I'm hunting the origin of knowledge. And the plan is for me to bring back the origin of knowledge in my suitcase for my students in September. For this journey, I have a partner in crime. Her name was Hannah Arendt. She's dead. She was a political theorist. How do you feel about me being Hannah Arendt today? Would you have liked to have the body of Hannah Arendt in the archive? Am I a monster? Are you a monster? I am not a monster.
They're just meeting people and asking them what is truth, what is white and what is black. That's great, but you know, just be careful, don't be executed like Socrates.
This one is from Nadia of Pussy Riot. And she wanted her puppet to be with you.
Why does this country just go about its business in the face of a president whose behavior can be characterized as radically evil?
When the atom bombs were dropped, that is when, for the first time, humanity existed. That is, when the possibility that all humanity could go arose, humanity itself was born.
To think in action as far as one speak, you said. Well, to think in action as far as one speak is not that easy to put into practice, let me tell you this.
In a nutshell, what is radical imagination? So radical imagination, you might think about it like, okay, it's just imagining different future, but actually it's got a proper ingrain into, you know, sociology and, you know, in the sense that it's the idea that, and it's the ability to imagine that the world, life, and social institution, not as they are, but as they might otherwise be. It is a courage and the intelligence to recognize that the world can and should be changed. The radical imagination is not just about dreaming of different future, it's about bringing those possibilities back from the future to work in the present, to inspire action and new form of solidarity today. So in a nutshell, if you really want to activate this power change in institution, you're gonna have to start looking into collective experience, looking at ways that this collective experience can start looking into the past, acknowledging it and kind of like pushing it into the present. And you're gonna start looking at social movements and how they can, you know, these movements can effectively like support, you know, and fight effectively a system of oppression and how they are in permanent movement. So these kind of like events, they need to be in permanent movement just for the reason that they're always gonna be try to be stopped in a nutshell. You know, when you start to develop a project that is gonna be really radically shifting people's mind, you're always gonna have yourself being cut off while you're in the middle of it. So one good example of that, and I'm gonna get into, you know, I'm sorry if some of you have already, you know, and you know this kind of work, but I think it's, you know, a very simple way of like showcasing it, you know, and showcasing it into the practice. So about 10 years ago, I hacked my way into NASA, which is, you know, this military agency based in the US. As you can imagine, it wasn't easy. It took me 7 years of heavy hammering. And I went there to actually make something called the International Space Orchestra. Now, what is the International Space Orchestra? It's a bunch of scientists coming from all the different, you know, departments of NASA. Astronaut Gagel is playing the percussion, you know, the director of NASA is playing the gong, and everyone is reenacting not the beauty of space mission, but everything that went wrong in the space program. And off you go, you know, we also have like a Russian interface operator, we have a baby in the International Space Orchestra. I mean, it gets completely surreal the more you go into it. But the most exciting part about this whole project is, of course, I received a lot of threatening messages doing it. I pretty much feel like if I'm an astronaut right now. The International Space Orchestra, it's a world first, right? It's never been done before. I mean, NASA Ames is such a massive place, 2,500 researchers. So it's as well bringing this whole event together, so then we call all meet and make something happen. Yes, it's going to be very enjoyable, but then also it's going to be quite hard work. So I just hope that you're all going to take part in this and like take it with the right attitude.
You remind me of a good con artist.
A good what?
What a con artist.
Someone who can sell anything to anybody.
Test tubes, go! Beaker, go! Ethanol spray, go! Capcom, we are go for powered descent.
We're here, we're on the moon, this is it. That should almost be, every word is just like a crystal coming through. The eagle has landed.
I'm kind of a perfectionist, and I'm a pretty high energy person.
You know, science is black and white, and music probably isn't, but it still takes a creative mind to do it.
When we go wherever we're gonna go, be it Mars or beyond, you have to take the human spirit with you or we won't survive or thrive where we're going.
I mean, they're never gonna be the Philharmonic, all right? But that's not the point.
Tour de Moon, really quickly, is a festival that was celebrating nightlife and youth counterculture all around the UK. Now, what we did was to actually look at alternatives. And if we weren't there to celebrate British creativity, then what shall we celebrate? And for us, it was at the essence, the idea of celebrating youth and youth center, which, you know, closed down 50% during the COVID, the COVID crisis. And the other part of the story was also nightlife and nightlife culture and how important nightlife is for youth counterculture to express themselves and to actually find a space net when, you know, families might not exist, they exist in nightlife. So, you know, how can we support that with the medium that we had, which was, you know, this pitch. So we won the pitch with this festival called Tour de Moon, which in essence is a very pluridisciplinary, I'm going to show you a few things that we've done with it. But in its essence, it's there is moon games, there is cinema, there is film. I mean, it's very pluralistic in its also in its offering. It's a touring convoy going in Bletchley, all around England, basically. You know, you had a convoy as well that were going there. But what was interesting to me is everything we did was very much done across looking at this as the core element of the commissioning. The Tour de Moon experience was in a nutshell about being meaningful, so bringing together, you know, people from all different sectors, whether they come from science, technology, the art, mathematics, and so forth. It was non-human centric. We were looking at, for example, collaborating with moths, with squids, with, you know, natural species, fungi, and so forth. It was decentralized in organic, all of the funding. You know, we collaborated with OnlyFans, we collaborated with TikTok, we collaborated with Instagram. We kind of infiltrated basically the places where our audience were, you know, 18 to 25 effectively. Collaborative, innovative, pluralistic, you know, and with a lot of humor. And that's something I'm extremely proud about, is the idea that actually, from the essence and from the start of the strategy behind the festival, for me, success was actually it going completely wild and it going completely out of control. So we disseminated the branding, we gave away all of the tools, we had, you know, we had open calls, everyone could apply everywhere in the world, it wasn't just limited in the UK. You could make a new film, we could support new beginnings, you know, essentially was the fact that it should be your first ever paid, you know, commission in writing, commission in, you know, and it was really about supporting these new beginnings. But effectively, it was also about the idea that, you know, everything is going to go and actually people are going to take it for themselves and make something different of it. So this is Archie, this is some of the pictures of the convoys. We had Moon Hotline as well, where we were able to actually talk to the moon via, we actually did an all-new artificial intelligence developed by youth centers and youth organization, which kind of put together an old script about what they would like to talk about, if they were to talk about, you know, with the moon or with a sort of extraterrestrial, you know, kind of body. What is it that you want to heal around? And so forth. And then with Moon Games, we are looking at new games based on equity. Anyway, it was like a monster beast. We fixed buildings that to this date were empty. We turned them into youth center. They are still to this date youth center. I'm extremely proud of saying that we worked with the policymakers, we worked with the council, we made it so that it has a legacy, stay there. We turned around a lot of things, you know, at the beginning, people didn't understand the idea of a license, you know, as opposed to owning intellectual property, but maybe we can talk about this in terms of commissioning model. You know, when you get a grant like that, people will want you to, anything you commission, they will want to own, because it's safer, right? Like, you're not gonna get a claim if someone is like, oh, this is my piece of music now that is being played and I didn't agree to this, right? So there is this tendency in our society, which is very colonial, and that's what I mean about unlearning, this idea that we need to own. Everything we pay for, we need to own. But why is that? How does that make sense? You know, for an artist, their intellectual property or designer, their intellectual property is everything. You don't want to rip that off from anyone. And if any of you are funders here, never even dare to go anywhere close to the IP of an artist, because I will come after you, I tell you that straight. But that's kind of that was kind of a big thing for me, trying to actually make them understand to change the rules, change the legality of the festival, so that we could actually support new work being produced, but also make sure that it belonged to the creators. And so every night different event, every night different performances, you know, Moon Cinema and so forth, which were, you know, Moon Cinema was in a nutshell like each of the grantees were looking into things that matter to them. If they were to kind of communicate with the moon, what would they say about our planet at this point in time? And so a lot of the topics were to do with, you know, mental health, with support system, with, you know, food, with how do you support your community, with nightlife, with, you know, things that matter to youth counterculture at this point in time in history that we have unfortunately failed to maintain. Anyway, I'm gonna really quickly, shall I talk about the University of the Underground? All I'm gonna say about this is like University of the Underground, like you mentioned, Priya, is free, pluralistic and transnational. It exists beyond border. I strongly believe that you cannot just rely on governmental bodies to provide you with education, whether it's free or not. I think personally I'm very always doubtful about governments in general, but that's only me, and of course, but you know, I also come from a family where, you know, we've been, we don't trust, like, you know, we don't trust government that easily, I will say. But I will say one thing for me is, like, if we were to actually come up with another far right, which, you know, you could argue perhaps we are in the middle of it, then how do you actually build platforms for independent thinking and freedom of thinking to be and to exist? That's, in essence, the idea of the University of the Underground, is how can we build a new federation of care that doesn't rely only on public funding, but kind of rely on other alternative funding, whether they are private, corporate responsibility, and other donations, citizen donations, and so forth, so that if we end up with authoritarian regime being put in place, then we have freedom of thinking in place. We can effectively support, you know, some form of resistance in a way, or at least very importantly to us, like this idea of freedom of thinking. And of course, Arendt is at the core of it. So this is what he looks like. This is in the basement of a nightclub in Amsterdam, where, you know, the students kind of like learn about linguistics, they learn about political science, they learn, it's a very pluridisciplinary program, but you learn about production management. It still is very much tailored toward the design of an event within an institution. You select an institution of your choice, one that you want to change, you find a way to get into it, you infiltrate it, you work within it, and then you actually develop something that is going to be, you know, critical, but also empowering to the workforce so that they themselves can take ownership of the future of their institution, effectively. And I should be, please do look online at the University of the Underground, because we're going to restart with a new program very soon. So do sign up if you want to join the University of the Underground. It is free, like I said. And it will be soon delivering as well, again, master programs. And so that's kind of like, we're doing a lot of different projects. We go in different places. This is in Cairo, you know, whether it's in the US. We work with the Pentagon. We do like really strange projects in places that you wouldn't expect. I would like to finish by maybe just sharing with you a bit of a song by the International Space Orchestra.
This is International Space Orchestra, Go, No, Go for launch.
Go! Go!
Mr. Pop.
Out of our solar system into the universe, seeking only peace and
friendship. We are fortified, grateful, we are fortunate. We know full well that our planet awaits inhabitants. Would you like to understand the meaning of the number of people? And the
you go. going off.